Non, c'est à moi, je vais chier après le fond. Le vivre, dans les choix, la vie de vivre. Ça court, mon côté. C'est vraiment volé.
Okay, so good morning. So we discussed last time several different transporters and ion channels, which have different ways of activation, different ways of energy coupling, or coupling of different sorts of energies. And today we'll do the last section of this chapter, which will describe the basic components at the setup side: neurotransmitters, receptors, and transport proteins. All of them we meet at the synapse site. Okay, this is where we will meet the neurotransmitter receptors. So as was the case previously, where we saw that some channels are voltage gated or something else gated, so this time they are ligand gated, or specifically in synapses, neurotransmitter gated receptors, or just neurotransmitter receptors. And they can be one of two types. So the first one, which will be this section today, are channels that open immediately upon neurotransmitter binding, and these are channels or proteins that are themselves a channel. So after, it's the same protein that meets the neurotransmitter, that recognizes it, and opens a channel in the plasma membrane. And this is in contrast to the second type of channels of receptors, that are G-protein coupled receptors. And it's a big and important family, and this is actually the next chapter will be dedicated only for these proteins. And the difference is that these proteins induce an opening or a closing of a separate protein, of a separate ion channel, and usually the kinetics of this kind of proteins is also slow, on the scale of about seconds or even minutes. Okay, so today's section will be about the ligand-gated ion channels. And before that, more about neurotransmitters. So what kind of molecules are neurotransmitters? So they're usually amino acids or derivatives of amino acids. And here are a few examples. So glycine and glutamate are two amino acids that can play a structural role in a protein, an enzymatic role in an enzyme, and also serve as a neurotransmitter. And these two we actually met at one of the articles we read together. Dopamine, norepinephrine, and epinephrine are all derivatives of tyrosine, which is an amino acid. It's just a wide view about of the main neurotransmitters found in our body. Serotonin is derived from tryptophan. Again, it's a neurotransmitter we met in Kandel's paper. Histamine, derived from histidine. And GABA, or GABA aminobutyric acid, is derived from glutamate. But also other, usually small molecules such as ATP, that lacks phosphate groups, can function as neurotransmitters. And again, it would be a good point just to mention again the I think, ambiguous nature of definitions between a neurotransmitter and a neuromodulator. I'm not sure what the definitions are, but just it's worthwhile saying that neuromodulators are distributed in a broader way than neurotransmitters. They usually affect not just a single postsynaptic cell, but several cells, and they, a lot of times, this is what models show, affect not only the neuronal transmission per se, but again the neuronal transmission. In other words, how sensitive the postsynaptic site would be to a transmission, to a transmission through the synapse. So neuromodulator, broader distribution affects usually gain of the synapse, sensitivity of the synapse, in opposed to neurotransmitter.
versus ATP, which left phosphate groups?
Perhaps just a bad phrasing. So AMP, this is ATP, adenosine triphosphate, and adenosine monophosphate is the one that usually uses serves as a neurotransmitter. Just yeah. So ATP is the generic name. Okay, each neuron generally produces just one type of neurotransmitter, and this is why you would find, you usually hear researchers say, so we investigated cholinergic neurons, we investigated GABAergic neurons, and so on. And what they actually meant to say is that they investigated neurons that produce this or that neurotransmitter. And it's not necessary that this neuron would be sensitive to or would have receptors that bind and recognize these neurotransmitters. So neurons, per definition, are defined by the neurotransmitters that they produce, and not necessarily by the neurotransmitter that they will be sensitive to. Neurotransmitters are synthesized at the cytosol and are then packed into vesicles, synaptic vesicles, which are then transported to the plasma membrane, bound there. We will see the whole process in more details in a couple of slides. And bound to the plasma membrane at the axon terminals, the presynaptic site. And then there they are stored. They are about 50 to 50 nanometer in diameter, the synaptic vesicles, packed with neurotransmitters. And their inside is rich with protons, has low pH, which is the cause of the operation of the V-class pump, which we discussed previously, which pumps protons into different vesicles, in this case synaptic vesicles. And the high proton concentration inside of the synaptic vesicles is used to move neurotransmitters via ligand-specific proton-linked antipodders. So antipodders are the ones that sit on the synaptic vesicles, and by taking out the proton or coupling the energy of taking a proton down its concentration gradient, this is what serves them to allow them to take a neurotransmitter up its concentration gradient and into the synaptic vesicle, and hence to pack the vesicle with the neurotransmitter.
Isn't it possible for a neuron to produce excitatory, inhibitory neurotransmitters? You said that it's just one type of neurotransmitters, but isn't there various effects?
Single neurons that produce more than single neurotransmitter?
I ask because, for example, if I want to send an inhibitory signal,
right,
it cannot be the same neurotransmitter, so there must be more than one in the arsenal.
I'm not sure if I think the canonical example, or the way the textbook describes it, is the one neuron can synthesize a single neurotransmitter, either inhibitory or excitatory.
So one neuron.
If there are some neurons, I'm not 100% positive. If there are no neurons that produce more than a single, I should check it.
Yeah,
but
I think there are, because sometimes they send
projection. But it also has to do with the postsynaptic receptors.
That's not the general case, for sure.
So they can send only excitatory information? Okay.
The neurotransmitter isn't defined as being excitatory or inhibitory, it's the receptor.
So again, it has to do with the receptors postsynaptic. I'm not sure if, for generally speaking, signaling molecules can be inhibitory and excitatory, not only in neurons, in kidneys, for instance, in liver, that's for sure. About neurons, about the central nervous system, I'm not sure. I can't think of any. Is there any in the central nervous system, in the brain? Is there a neurotransmitter that serves both, etc.? I'm not sure.
Okay.
But I think okay, I'll check it.
Thank you.
All right. So each neurotransmitter has its own antiporter, or more specifically, it's the proton-linked antiporter that serves or that packs it into vesicles. Okay. this is an example of the antiporter for acetyl choline, which is a neurotransmitter, which is, by the way, not an amino acid, not even a derivative of amino acid, it's just a synthesized molecule itself that serves as neurotransmitters, again, acetyl choline. And you see that the antiporter uses the downhill movement of protons outside of the synaptic vesicle to transport acetylcholine into the vesicle. Now, there's an interesting story between the following two components in the cholinergic system. So acetylcholine is produced, this is acetylcholine, and the chemical reaction that describes its production. It is composed of two components, two molecules, acetyl-CoA and choline. And the enzyme that promotes this reaction is called choline acetyl transferase. This is the one that takes these two, link them together to give rise to acetyl choline, the intact functional neurotransmitter. Independently and in parallel to this, we have the antiporter proton-linked acetyl choline antiporter that packs acetyl choline molecules into the synaptic vesicle. Now, if the cell has to have or wants to increase its levels of cholinergic transmission, or in other words, want to have more packed neurotransmitters in synaptic vesicles. So it makes a lot of sense to couple these two processes together, because if it will only upregulate the gene that codes for the choline acetyltransferase, then this step will serve as a bottleneck. So it will produce more acetylcholine, but will not increase the level or the rate in which they are packed into the synaptic vesicles, then no effective upregulation of cholinergic transmission will occur, right? And the other way around as well. So if you increase the level of this protein, so the production of acetylcholine will serve as a bottleneck. So it makes a lot of sense to couple these two processes together. So and neurons can couple such pairs of processes together in many different ways, post-translationally, pre-translationally, and so on. In this case, it is coupled really at the level of the genome itself, because the gene that codes for this protein and the gene that codes for this one sits at the same genomic site. More specifically, the gene coding the antiporter is contained entirely within the first intron, but we haven't defined an intron yet, so it's just contained entirely within the genome region where this protein sits, where the enzyme sits. And so the outcome is that these two have the same promoter or are controlled by the same promoter region, genomically. And so when the one is expressed or transcribed, and later on translated, so the other one is transcribed as well. And then an effective increase of cholinergic transmission. And this is a phenomenon that is very conserved throughout evolution. Cholinergic system exists in a lot of kingdoms in nature. Okay, so we are now at the synapse site. So we talked a little about how we pack neurotransmitters into synaptic vesicles. Now this picture here will describe the cycle of secretion or fusion of synaptic vesicles with the plasma membrane and secretion of the neurotransmitter and recycling of the process of the vesicles and the neurotransmitter back to the presynaptic site. It's a process that takes about typically 60 seconds, about 1 minute. So we are looking at the presynaptic site. Here we have the synaptic cleft, and down further down we have the postsynaptic site. So we now focus on the cytosolic site or the presynaptic. And it's a common mistake to think that the action potential or the depolarization that is the action potential when it reaches the axon terminal on the presynaptic site pushes the neurotransmitter vesicles out of the cell or something of the sort. So what really happens, you have to have another step in the chain of events that the calcium gives you. And what actually happens is that the bound vesicle, when the depolarization arrives to the presynaptic site, voltage-gated calcium channels, so we've already met voltage-gated in sodium and potassium channels, but voltage-gated calcium channels, this time are the ones that open, because they're voltage-gated upon depolarization that reaches, hence the action potential that reaches the axon terminal. These channels are open, calcium flows into the cell, conformationally change a lot of stuff, a lot of things in the cell, among them proteins that harbor or anchor the synaptic vesicles on the plasma membrane. These are the PECT vesicles. And this causes these vesicles to fuse with the plasma membrane and to the neurotransmitter to synthesis, to be secreted to the synaptic cleft. Okay, a word about these two populations. And in a minute we'll follow what happens postsynaptically. Okay, so these are the PECT vesicles, and they are then transported or move towards the axon. This is done somewhere in the cytosol, and they are then moved towards the plasma membrane. Now, researchers, mainly electrophysiologists, usually refer to two populations of synaptic vesicles, synaptic vesicles. The first ones are the ones that are still unanchored or unharbored on the plasma membrane, although they are on the way to become such vesicles. And the second kind of population is the for the vesicles that are already bound, already anchored upon the plasma membrane. And upon tetanic stimulation, meaning prolonged and strong enough stimulation, you will see two waves of exhaustion in the electrophysiology experiment. And the first one will represent the exhaustion of this kind of vesicles, of the anchored vesicles, which are in a standby, in a ready state. To secrete the vesicle, sorry, the content, the neurotransmitter to the synaptic cleft. And only afterwards you will see the second wave of exhaustion, which represents the docking and then the effusion of this population of synaptic vesicles. Okay, so this is the first half of the cycle. And then neurotransmitter is spilled to the synaptic cleft, and we will follow it in a minute. What happens afterwards, still in the presynaptic site, is recycling the synaptic vesicles and independently of the neurotransmitters back to the presynaptic site. So locally, where the synaptic vesicles have been fused with the plasma membrane via a clathrin-dependent process, the vesicles are then internalized back into the presynaptic site or reformed to give an uncoated vesicle. And independently, via the work of symporters for each kind of neurotransmitter, the neurotransmitters are taken up back to the presynaptic site from the cleft. And as seen here, it is indeed usually a process that uses sodium for the downhill gradient, the concentration gradient of sodium, to reuptake the neurotransmitter back to the presynaptic site. Because energetically it's a favorable process, because sodium is high outside and low outside, and the negative inside of the cell has a lot of energy to be utilized. So reuptake of neurotransmitter, local recycling of the synaptic vesicles by the protein clathrin, and then we go back to the first step where vesicles can be packed with neurotransmitters via the transporters, the antiporters that sit on the membrane.
What happens to the neurotransmitters?
So the neurotransmitters are then packed, reuptake into the cytosol, and then packed again into the recycled vesicles right here. And neurotransmitters can be used several times in several transmissions. Not sure about how much, but okay. So all in all, this cycle very much resembles the principle process of exocytosis that happens in all sorts of cells, not only neurons, which goes the other way around as the process we mentioned of endocytosis with different mechanisms spread. But in neurons it has two distinct features. Okay, so the first is the secretion, in this case of neurotransmitters, is tightly coupled with the arrival of an action potential to the presynaptic site, to the axon terminus. This is unique to neurons. second picture that's unique to neurons is the synaptic vesicles, as we saw here, are locally recycled back into the site where they were secreted, from where they were secreted. Yes, and this is again something that's unique to neurons.
The tunnel of the uptake is the same channel as the sodium channel? How do they get back into the
neuron? So it's not exactly a channel, it's a transporter. Specifically in a symporter, because it takes same molecules to the same side of the plasma membrane, right? It's not a sodium channel. Sodium channel, it's to the background of it. It has to function somewhere here, but so it's a sodium linked, some kind of neurotransmitter symporter.
Right.
And it's also not to be confused with the antiporters for neurotransmitters that are the ones that spec them into the synaptic vesicles. So these are different types of proteins that take them back to the after they were secreted. Okay, something about it. The whole process of kiss and I heard once this term. Okay, so kiss and run because it's fused into the plasma membrane and then reformed. So the run is when they are recycled into the plasma in this cytoplasm. All right. Kiss and run, fuse and run, something like that. All right. And we will now follow these neurotransmitters to the postsynaptic site where they will be recognized by the postsynaptic receptors. Okay, as long as the neurotransmitter is at the synaptic site, you have synaptic transmission. It can be terminated by either degradation of the neurotransmitter or reuptake of the neurotransmitter as we just described. Specific example, the acetylcholine case, the neurotransmitter is hydrolyzed by an enzyme called acetylcholine esterase, which is localized to the synaptic cleft. So it breaks down the acetylcholine, this enzyme breaks down acetylcholine at the synaptic cleft, and then separately, only one part of the hydrolyzed component, only the choline, is transported back to the presynaptic site. Then the transferase, the enzyme that promotes the production of acetylcholine, cytosolic enzyme, will produce a new acetylcholine molecule back again. Okay, so again, one word about these symporters. So this one's a symporter for the red, for a specific kind of neurotransmitter. So for GABA, norepinephrine, dopamine, serotonin, all of their transporters, and this time we mean the symporters, the sodium-linked symporters that are responsible for the reuptake process, are very, very much alike. They have about 70% identical in the amino acid sequence. Now when you take a sodium into the cell, it's what we call electrogenic process, as was the case when we tried to build a gradient of protons inside lysosomes. So chlorine is often transported with the sodium via a chloride channel to sustain electron neutrality. Because otherwise you will build positive charges inside the cell. Okay, and interestingly, a lot of cognitive phenomena are linked with exactly the processes we just described, the reuptake of neurotransmitters. There's a lot of substances, synthetic and natural occurring substances, that affect precisely this process. So cocaine, for instance, blocks dopamine reuptake. Fluoxetine, usually known as Prozac, blocks serotonin reuptake. And acetylcholine blocks norepinephrine reuptake. Each of these neurotransmitter systems is fairly well associated with a specific cognitive function. And so for some reason, it's the reuptake state that is very sensitive to different chemicals.
Is there anything about reuptake and dopamine reuptake and serotonin uptake?
No, same one, sorry. No, reuptake of serotonin as well. Okay, just to mentioned that the neurotransmitters, the function that the synapse, that is a unique synapse, it's a synapse between, not between two neurons, but between a neuron cell and a muscle cell. So we're not dealing with the central nervous system. So in this instance, it's actually the peripheral nervous system. So the neurotransmitter that function in this synapse, which is also called the neuromuscular junction or synapse, because it's again a synapse between a neuron and a muscle, is acetylcholine. This is a very nice EM figure that shows the presynaptic site, okay, with the back synaptic vesicles. These circles right here, the synaptic left. Okay, so the upper line is the boundary of the presynaptic membrane, and then you have the other side is the postsynaptic membrane. In this case, of the muscle cell. And then these muscle contractile proteins are obviously just components we find only in muscle cells, but this part of the image is exactly what we'll find between two neurons. So synaptic vesicles will are then fused into the presynaptic membrane, secrete the neurotransmitter, which then passes the synaptic cleft and recognized by receptors at the postsynaptic site. Okay, we'll mention just one type of receptor for acetylcholine, which is, as was the case for the NMDA receptor, that is termed after a synthetic molecule, an exogenous molecule, meaning a molecule that does not occur in the brain of organisms in nature, or not an endogenous molecule. So also here, the acetylcholine receptor X was termed after this substance, nicotine, which is again not naturally occurring in brains of organisms. You have to take it in, you have to consume it. It's called the nicotinic acetylcholine receptor, which sits on the plasma membrane of several postsynaptic cells, in this instance of a muscle cell. And when it recognizes acetylcholine, it opens and it can admit both calcium and sodium ions, so it's a cation channel, general cation channel. Experiments show that the release of one acetylcholine vesicle from the presynaptic site results in the opening of about 2,000 ion channels at the postsynaptic site. Okay, let's see this channel in a bit more details. So it's a pentameric protein, and more precisely a heteropentrope pentamer, because it's made of five unidentical units. And when two molecules of acetylcholine binds to two sites in the interface of these two pairs of subunits, then conformational change occurs at the protein, and more particularly each subunit of the pentamer rotates on its vertical axis, and so the kink right here no longer faces the gate, but now faces towards the phospholipid bilayer, and so effectively a channel is open, or the gate is open. There's high concentration of negative charges at the entrance region, and they are thought to serve as a magnet to the cations. This is why this channel passes cations. And in opposed to what we saw in the passive non-gated potassium channel and also sodium channel, where the ions pass without their water molecule shell in a high unhydrated form, here sodium and ion and potassium ions pass with their shell of water molecule. So it's a different mechanism of passing through the gate. Question, you recall that in the passive non-gated channel, they exchange their interaction with the oxygen of the water molecule with interactions of the oxygens from the protein itself. So, okay, this is just a model that shows the interaction between this pentameric protein and the venom of a cobra snake. So it's thought.
Every positive ion can pass through the channel?
Basically, yes, but because usually it will be open upon depolarization. No, I'm not sure it's true. Basically, yes. What gives it the specificity to sodium and potassium as opposed to calcium, for instance? I'm not sure. Yeah, I'm not sure. No, but the electrochemical force for calcium in okay, I'm not sure. So it's thought that five cobra venom molecules interact again in the interface between the subunits around this pentamer and block any rotation of the of its subunits on its axis or any conformational change in this protein. And this is what causes paralysis in muscles or death if the paralysis reaches the heart muscles. And so although in this case neurotransmitter can be released or cholinergic transmission can be performed, still the protein is stuck in this form because of the cobra venom. There's a lot of war going on between organisms on different ion channels. Try to attack each other through blockage of conformational changes in receptor and ion channels. So this is what the different venom science describes. Alright, so to sum up, we've met several, the canonical or groups of ion channels and transporters that we find in neurons and in all other cells as well. We focus on their role specifically in neurons. So we saw that the ATP-powered pumps together with the non-gated ion channels are the ones that are responsible for the inside negative of neurons. Inside negative protection, not action. Inside negative potential, membrane potential, in neurons and in cells. Co-transport by simples and antipoders. We met several tasks that are performed by these proteins. Voltage gated, then ligand gated, which are the active ion channels, and where they sit, what they do. So again, I would recommend go over this chapter again. We will read an article next week together. We will read it at home and we'll do it together next week. I'll send it by email afterwards. That's a little bit based on several things, several concepts we've learned here. Okay, so this is it for this chapter. And I think perhaps we will take the break right now, and when we come back, we will proceed with the next chapter of the G protein coupled receptor that we just saw a different kind of a function for our channel. Okay, so let's take 15 minutes break and then.
Thank you.
הזו הוא מזוהה בשני אתרים על גבי התעלה הזו ונשאר תקוע כאן. כן, הוא לא עובר, כאילו הוא מזוהה על ידי הצד החיצוני של הצד האקסטרה סלולרי של הרצפטור, ואז יש שינוי מבנים ברצפטור, ואז הוא ואז נפתח את התעלה. זה מה שאומר זה היום, אני רוצה לדעות נשאר בצד הסקרט, ואז הוא הידרולייז. תראה, אני רוצה שנינו צריך להגיע לקלף ולעשות סיגנלים כל יום אחד.
נכון, אבל כשהוא חוזר, כאילו,
יש לך גם את הסיכון של הפרוט וגם לא
מסתכלות.
כן, נכון, בנפרד. שני
חוזרים, כאילו, כל אחד
בפני עצמו,
בתוך
אותה. כן, הוא, זאת אומרת, הווסיקל נבנה מחדש, אני רוצה שמיתו, לא נבנה, אלא מוכנס מחדש, ואז זה שבא לבנה מחדש, וזה
אנחנו
זה. הכונן,
כאילו, מספיק
חזרה לתוך הסייטוזון. ואז אחד נראה את השני, זה נכון, זה דני אולי, כן. אפשר לעשות את הדברים אצל יעיל, ואתה, זה הרבה מקומות.
כן.
כן. טוב. כאילו כן, לא? לא.
Thank you. through nothing of it, in some area of Uber.
So deep brain and cap receptors. So there's a big group of or a family of proteins that of receptors that act through G proteins and hence are G protein coupled receptors. And then they function in many processes in the body, including vision, digestion, smell, taste. And their receptors, or the receptors, are can be found in, again, in a lot of kingdoms in nature that are very highly conserved. And only in the human genome alone, there are several thousands of genes that code for proteins that are receptors of G protein. So do you know which sense, bodily sense, is has the biggest array of receptors? So it's, yeah, it's
no, not the test, sorry. Just close, so we know.
Right, it's the smell, where you have a receptor or a gene that codes for a receptor for each and every odorant in the odorant world or in the outside world. This is in opposed to vision, which is more a combinatorial function between three principal receptors and so on. But so it's the smell. So a lot of the genome, even today, even for modern humans, which the smell is kind of a less dominant body sense, I should say, still we have thousands of receptors, which are again G-protein coupled receptors. And this is even before the overview, just to give the bird's view of the different chemicals that can serve as signaling molecules in signaling between cells and particularly via G protein. So signaling molecules that function in cell-to-cell communication can be amino acids, lipid derivatives, peptides, proteins. The signaling molecule will interact with the receptor in the plasma membrane from the exoplasmic side, and some of them will induce, I don't know, phosphorylation of transcription or activation through phosphorylation of transcription factors. Others will induce activation through removal of subunits from certain genes or proteins that will then serve as transcription factors, will translocate and move through the past the nuclear membrane and into the nucleus to serve as transcription factors. So this is the common case in which the signaling molecule interacts with the outside, with the exoplasmic side of a receptor. In more rare cases, signaling molecules can also penetrate the cytosol, where they will meet cytosolic receptors. So, for instance, steroids are such molecules. And the signaling molecules serve or act as a ligand to this receptor, and it binds by a structurally complementarity with the receptor, which is a combination, or which is maintained by a combination of weak interactions, the ones we've discussed. Now, the whole process of converting the signal, or I would say the whole process of that starts with the recognition of the signaling molecule on the receptor, and through activation of intracellular processes, and sometimes ending with transcription of novel genes or synthesis of new proteins, the whole process is called signal transduction. So people say signal transduction, but they sometimes mean only the steps that occur on the membrane, only the steps that occur in the nucleus, and so on. The whole process is signal transduction. And by the way, for process, so G proteins can act through any of these different pathways, principal pathways. Okay, so we'll start with basic principles about signal transduction. We'll then give some basic principles about the structure and the function of G proteins. We'll then meet three different pathways by which G proteins act. The first are G-coupled receptors that affect adenylate cyclase. The second, those that regulate ion channels. And the third, those that activate phospholipase C. Three different but canonical examples, textbook examples. We will then finish with the final steps that sometimes occur for G protein pathways, and that is activation of gene transcription at the nucleus. functional transduction. So signaling molecule can be classified into three types of depending on the distance between the cell that secreted the molecule and the cell that received it. So in endocrine signaling, the cell that secretes the molecule is far away from the cell that received it. And so the molecule has to be carried by some medium, right? So usually it is the blood. And this is endocrine signal. So hormones, for instance, can be secreted from some brain region and affect some target organ a meter or a meter and a half far away from where they were secreted. In paracrine signaling, the signaling molecule affects target cells that are in close proximity to the cell that secreted the signaling molecule. Very the distance is short. And specific, so this is generally speaking, specific examples of paracrine signaling is neurotransmitters. Synapse is a paracrine creature. And growth factors, these are molecules that are secreted and received between adjacent cells as well and affect their growth. So this is also an example of paracrine signaling. There's also a weird process, autocrine signaling, in which cells secrete a substance to their environment and then take it in again, seize it again, or they write letters to themselves, so to speak, and then by that induce some intracellular process. Now in first glance, in second glance as well, it looks a bit weird. Why should a cell secrete something and then take it up again only in order to induce some intracellular process? Why not instead more directly activate the process? So again, biologists, when they see such a process or such a not effective process, so they the claim is that during the course of evolution, one process or one system, in this particular case the paracrine and endocrine signaling, preceded the autocrine signaling. So this system or process was based or used the components that were built and developed for these signaling systems. Okay, some signaling molecules or a given signaling molecule can act in more than one signaling type, can act both short and long range. So for instance, epinephrine is also a paracrinic neurotransmitter and an endocrinic hormone. Okay. Depends on what it does, but then we decide how to call it. Okay, there are also, so these are all molecules that they're responsible for cell-to-cell communication within the organism. There are also molecules that worthwhile mention here, which we will not discuss, that responsible for chemical communication between organisms. You know what these molecules are? Again, chemical molecules that can carry pheromones. So pheromones are molecules that are, again, chemical signaling molecules that are passed between organisms. I think it's not 100% thing yet whether we have pheromones in humans or not, but for mice, we already know that it exists, other organisms as well. I think evidence is being accumulated that for humans it exists as well. Okay. It's an interesting thing to check out. Okay, but these are the three within organism signaling systems. External signals, when they are received on a cell, they can induce or convey their function through one of two ways: either change the activity of a protein that already exists, that's already there, or change the amount of a protein, meaning the synthesis of the novel of a protein. So they can either affect post-translationally, right, this would be A, or pre-translationally. again, G-protein and kappa receptors can act on both in both ways. Some receptors or some classes of receptors can initiate signaling via more than one intracellular process. And so that leads to different cellular responses per activation of a receptor. So there is a divergence when we move from the receptor activation level to the intracellular process activation or induction. There's a divergence because, again, each receptor can cause different variable intracellular processes. But there's also a convergence when moving between these two layers, because despite the huge number of different kinds of ligands and their specific receptors, there is a relatively small number of single transduction mechanisms exist in the cell. For instance, naming one substance we've already met, and again in Kandel's paper and in another point in the course, so activation of various receptors or several signaling receptors, their pathways end with the increasing level of cyclic entry. So this would be a divergence from the receptor level to the intracellular cascade. It's a common effect. Alright. Each receptor binds only a single or a few very closely related or very similar signaling molecule. So for a given receptor, you will have just one signaling molecule or just a few, which are pretty much almost the same molecule. But from the signaling molecule point of view, it's the other way around. So a single signaling molecule can bind multiple types of receptors, different cells, and in each receptor, it will cause different intracellular outcomes. In the case where the signaling molecule is a protein, as is the case for the growth hormone, so researchers can perform mutation experiments and then decide which of the amino acids are the ones essential for the binding with the receptor, and do the same thing on the receptor, which of the amino acids on the receptor are essential for binding with the ligand. So this is briefly, principally, how we identify regions in the ligand or the receptor that are essential for binding between the two. Alright, so here's an example of another divergence. So the neurotransmitter or the molecule acetylcholine can be, this is a representation of the second argument here. So acetylcholine, for instance, can be recognized by ligand-gated ion channels in muscle cells, where they will lead to muscle contraction. Same molecule can be recognized in heart cells, where they will, or G-protein kappa receptors in heart cells, so they will induce slowing down of the heart rate. And they can also be recognized by pancreatic cells, where they will induce digestive enzyme secretion. Same molecule. And it is that with putting aside the different effects that this molecule has on the brain. All right. Secondary messengers. Secondary messengers are usually a low molecular weight molecule, and they are the ones that transmit or the first. Okay, I'm not sure about the first step. They are part of the intracellular cascade. So the ligand bind the ligands, which are the neurotransmitters, the hormones and endocrine signaling, the ligand binding leads to short-lived increase or decrease in the low molecular weight second messengers. And so why do we call them second messengers? To who are they secondary? Who are the first messengers? The ligand that binds the receptor from the outside. These secondary messengers can be these nucleotides, AMP, with just a single phosphate, AMP, G, GMP usually in a cyclic form. All the derivatives of fatty acid chains, or of small sugars. Also, secondary messengers can be sometimes ions. Again, as in the case of condensed paper calcium. And again, in each cell, and even more particularly in each state in which a cell will be, the secondary messengers can have different effects. So in muscle cells, a rise in cytosolic calcium will trigger contraction. Same secondary messenger in endocrinic cells will cause secretion of vesicles, and in nerve cells will cause secretion of neurotransmitters. Right. So activation of all cells efferent receptors leads to a change in phosphorylation state for different proteins in the cell. And this is done by activation of either proteins that add phosphate groups, kinases, or proteins that remove phosphate groups, phosphatases. Okay, two types of protein kinases we have to distinguish between, to mention here. Some kinases, or the two groups are, again, those that add phosphate to hydroxyl groups on tyrosine residues, and others that add phosphate groups to serine or threonine residues. So each kinase can be either the first or the second type. And each protein kinase phosphorylates specific residues in a set of target proteins, and you can record the we describe at the atomic level the reaction that occurred at the active site of pKa. You remember that due to its structure, that its structure determines the target protein that it will phosphorylate. And many target proteins are substrates of multiple kinases. So this the phosphorylation state of a protein is determined by several components, the complicated things. Okay, there's a feature need to mention about signal transduction. So signal transduction proteins are very often localized to areas on the membrane, and they are localized or clusterized by adapter proteins that contain multiple protein binding domains. Okay, so this is a common picture of protein that we find at the postsynaptic site. There's a very highly abundant protein in the postsynaptic site called PSD95. It has multiple PDZ domains. The PDZ domain is a 9 amino acid domain. It binds to three residue sequence on another protein, specifically on the C-terminus of another protein, of target protein, and so serve as an adapter between different proteins. So you'll see that, for instance, the NMDA receptor that we've discussed binds to the PDZ domain on the PSD95, as well as an adhesive molecule that's found in neurons a lot of time, neuroligand, as well as other proteins. And through additional adapter proteins, the whole thing a lot of time is interacts with the cytoskeleton. The consensus sequence between the PDZ and the sequence that has to be found on the target protein or the interacting protein is quite degenerative. It's filled of either serine, threonine, any amino acid, or hydrophobic amino acid, or just the sequence of hydrophobic, any hydrophobic amino acid. So it's quite degenerative. It's more, usually we think of it as a protein has to have several of these motifs to be recognized by the PDZ domain or by the PSD95 protein, and then to be clusterized together with other proteins, signaling the transduction protein. Right. So termination of signaling via secondary messengers can, as was deactivation of a single transduction protein, so that so perhaps the second messenger is still there at high levels, but the protein itself no longer activate downstream effects. If you sustain a high signal and prolonged signal, meaning for a long duration of time, to some signal, it will cause receptor desensitization. Receptor desensitization can occur via receptor endocytosis. So this is just removal of the receptor from the plasma membrane. So obviously there will be no signal transduction through this receptor anymore. Receptor inability to bind the ligand, so the receptor is still there, but from conformational reasons, it is no longer able to bind the ligand, or it can bind the ligand, but not induce or activate downstream effectors. So the cascade stops there. Okay, so this is signal desensitization, receptor desensitization. These were a couple of principal concepts of intracellular transduction. We will see some of the concepts we mentioned in these specific examples. Before that, again, some principal discussion about the structure and the function of G-protein. So G-proteins, first of all, are members in a bigger family of GTPases, which are proteins that hydrolyze GTP, right? The GTPase, as you probably know by now, so this is a hydrolysis ability of GTP. They are tethered or anchored to the membrane by covalently attached lipid molecules. Okay, so this is an example of some receptor. Not the G protein is right here, and the trimeric G protein is built of alpha, beta, gamma subunits. Again, we'll see it in the next slide more clearly. And the receptor, that's the transmembranal receptor that activates it, is right here. The G protein itself is anchored to the plasma membrane from the inside, from the cytosolic side. And during intracellular signaling and activation of the G protein, the beta-gamma subunits remain bound together, and the alpha subunit dissociates from the beta-gamma and activates downstream effectors, such as phospholipase or the alpha pathway, specific pathways we'll see. The G alpha subunit is the GTPase unit of the G protein. So this is the one that binds GTP and hydrolyzes it to GDP. So the alpha subunit is the hydrolysis, the hydrolyzing. Several additional proteins regulate the function of the GTP, its hydrolysis, its rate of hydrolysis, its rate of insertion of a new GTP to the alpha subunit, and here are just a few. So the rate of GTP hydrolysis is enhanced by another protein, not the G protein, so another protein that's called GTPase accelerating protein, or just GAP, whose activity is also, by the way, controlled by extracellular signaling. So the efficiency in which the GTP hydrolysis occurs depends at large about at the activation of the GAP. Okay, activation of the, so this was about the rate of GTP hydrolysis, but the activation of the GTP itself is mediated by the guanine nucleotide exchanging factor, another necessary protein, regulatory protein, also called GAP. Okay, there are two classes of GTPase switch proteins. Even it's about the switch. GTP can be either trimeric G protein. For the previous slide was for a trimeric G protein. And these proteins directly activated by certain receptors. In opposed to the monomeric G proteins that are actually equivalent just to the alpha subunit of the trimeric G protein, also called the RAS family G protein, because this is an important G alpha that was recognized and everyone else was termed homologous to this protein. And these are Again, these are equivalent to the alpha subunit, to the alpha subunit in the trimeric G protein, and they are linked indirectly to receptors via other proteins. So they are not activated directly by transmembranal receptors, but they are activated some other way. We will mainly focus on this, on the trimeric G protein today. But just to mention that these two different types of GTP proteins are regulated in very different ways. It's just one way to say this. Okay, so we are looking right now at the alpha, the schematic representation of the alpha subunit of the trimeric G protein. In this specific study, it would be the same as just looking at the monomeric G protein, the RAS family G protein. So when a GTP binds its binding site on the alpha subunit, two segments turn switch 1 and 2 interact with the last phosphate at the GTP. This is the on state. In this state, the alpha subunit activates or affects downstream effectors. When there is a hydrolysis of GTP, and you'll see here the GTP that's remained in the long phosphate dissociates from the active site, then this will be, and the two segments no longer active, interact with the phosphate that was here. So this is the off state, and the alpha subunit does not affect no longer, and transduction stops. Energy proteins contain these regions, the switch 1 and 2, which modulate the activity of downstream effectors. Okay, usually the G alpha, again, the G alpha is the alpha subunit of the trimeric G protein. So the G alpha is usually the one that activates downstream effectors, but it is not always the case. Some cases it inhibited downstream effectors, and in other cases it's actually the beta gamma that activates downstream effectors, and the alpha remains passive. A trimeric G protein, an expressed given trimeric G protein in a cell, is not a single combination of alpha, beta, gamma subunits. Only in the human genome, there are 27 different genes that encode for G alpha, and certain G gamma subunits, and 5 G beta subunits. So that and a given trimeric G protein is a specific combination of each of these different options. This table describes some examples of possible combinations between alpha, beta, gamma. So these are for each G protein, trimeric G protein, we give some another name. So this one, the G protein that's functioning olfaction, and transducin is the one that's functioning vision. Never mind the name. This will be the associated effector, the downstream effector that's affected by the G protein, the secondary messenger that takes part in this cascade, and some specific examples. Again, this is just to show that the G protein primary version is a different combination of each of the subunits. Regarding the sequence of events in G protein activation. Okay, so this is the signaling molecule, in this case, that has a hormone. So upon activation of the hormone, upon a combination of the hormone in on the receptor becomes active, activates the G protein. And note that the G protein is tethered to the membrane separately. The alpha subunit is tethered to the membrane, and also the beta gamma subunit is tethered to the membrane. Each one has its own anchor, phospholipid anchor. Okay, then the receptor activates the G protein. Alpha subunit, this is the canonical, the more frequent case in which the alpha subunit is activated by exchange of the GDP that was here with the GTP, dissociates from the beta gamma, still anchored on the plasma membrane, and hence, because of the fluidity of the plasma membrane, it moves laterally, meets several downstream effectors, active effector, activates several, each one it meets, so it activates it, so it meets and activates several downstream effectors, as long as it is activated. And after a small duration of time, the alpha subunit, because it has a hydrolysis capacity, it hydrolyzes the GTP back to GDP. The activation stops, no longer the G-alpha activates downstream effectors. It reforms the, and then the complex of the alpha-beta-gamma is reformed right here. This is back to the initial state. So I'll just note that already here you have amplification of the signal. Why amplification? Because activation of a single alpha subunit will result in several active downstream effectors. So already here we have an amplification, and you will see that there are other steps between other steps in which we find amplification.
It seems like everything happens on the membrane.
So this here still everything happens on the membrane, indeed. Because this is where the receptor, the transmembrane receptor, and the G protein is tethered to the membrane, and later steps in the cascade will enter the cytosol and sometimes the nucleus. But up till now, indeed, we're in the membrane site. Okay. This is a method, actually, it's a general method to measure distance between two molecules in vivo. And we will mention it here in the context of measuring the distance between the alpha and the beta gamma subunit. So it's called Forster resonance energy transfer, or just FRET. So that is not as people think for fluorescence energy transfer, it's after the name of the one that invented it. And it shows the kinetics of alpha subunit dissociation. So we first have to fluorescently mark or label the beta gamma. Let's mark it with a yellow fluorescent dye. Sorry. And let's mark the alpha subunit with a blue fluorescent dye. Now, if you excite the blue dye, and the two molecules are in close proximity, some energy transfer will occur, and you will be able to read emission in the yellow wavelength. So, we'll be able. You'll be able to identify yellow intensity in the system. So this is the initial step, right here, the starting point. Now if we add the signaling molecule, in this case it's cyclic AMP, some signaling molecule, the receptor is activated, and then activates the GP, which its alpha units then dissociates from the beta gamma. Okay, we continue to excite the blue light, but then no emission of the yellow can be read, because when the two molecules are far away, no energy transfer occurs, or lower energy transfer occurs, and then lower yellow intensity will be read in the system. And this is what you see here, the drop in both curves. So the y-axis is the intensity of the yellow light. Okay, so first of all, you can say, and the vertical line is the ligand, it's when we added the ligand, okay? This is where the experiment started. So we can see activation by dissociation of the alpha from the beta gamma subunit, and you can actually measure more subtle features in the experiment. So what would you say is the difference between the experiment A and the experiment B in the G-protein when protein context? Which of the experiments the activation occurs faster? In A, because the drop occurs faster or earlier in time. And another thing one can note here is that in which experiment A or B do you have more activation or activation of a higher fraction of the G protein at the final stage? In B, because the difference from the starting point, this is 1, so you normalize by the starting point. It's farther away.
Is it?
So that means that I would say, like, if you let's turn the y-axis for percentages of G proteins that were activated. This is just estimation, but it makes sense to do it. So it's about 90 percent smaller. So it's about so this zero is for the x-axis. This will be, I don't know, let's say 70% of the G proteins were activated in the final stage of experiment B, as opposed to something closer to 80% in experiment A.
Does it measure how many were activated or how far away they go?
It's a good question. So it was an estimation. I'm not sure. No, I'll tell you what. If
I mean that.
If yeah, I'm not sure.
The line depends on how far away is it.
Right, but because we're in a saturation already, so I'm not sure. This was like just an intuition, just an interpretation, not a sound one. But because we're already in a saturation, that I would, I'm not sure. Maybe it's. Specific distance, of course, it doesn't tell you anything about it, but what you do know is that there is positive one-to-one correlation between the distance and the drop in the intensity of the yellow line. So the farther away, the farther the alpha unit subunit is from the beta and gamma, the more intensive, the more sharper the drop.
Okay.
Yeah. If one can measure the specific distance between, I'm not sure. That's a good thing.
You have to use microscopy for that, or that?
Well, microscopy will give you it, but in microscopy, yeah, like you're doing live imaging microscopy, yeah, perhaps. I mean, yeah, this is for sure, but I'm not sure if you have a, if you have some sort of transformation to measure.
I don't think so.
I don't know. Maybe, I don't know. Maybe if you normalize, you can, I don't know, you can sort of calibrate your experiment first. This is just what I'm thinking. If you do know the distance and the difference, so you can just put, you know, calibrate it. I don't know. Maybe people do it. Maybe. But this is the basic way that this method works.
Alright.
And now let's meet the first pathway in which that we will learn, in which G protein acts through the adenylate cyclase. Okay, we will start with the adenylate cyclase story, or the adenylate cyclase story, with a molecule called epinephrine, which mediates the body's response to stress. And it does it via several, sometimes opposing mechanisms, seemingly opposing mechanisms. You see what I mean in a second. So when epinephrine is recognized in adipose tissue, in liver tissue, it produces, it causes catabolism or production of glucose and fatty acids, which, as you already know, is a high energy available molecule to produce ATP. This is done via beta adrenergic receptors. Same epinephrine, when it meets, when it's recognized on heart muscles, increase the heart contraction rate through beta adrenergic receptors again. So increased heart contraction rate, meaning more blood flow to the tissues, right, to the peripheral tissues, mainly muscles in the body. But in opposed to this effect, so there's also a cutting of circulation to unneeded organs, unneeded in the sense that they are unneeded to the stress response. Or organs that do not take part in the stress response, such as skin. So this might be the cause why we of painness when the person is scared. And this is done via alpha adrenergic receptors. So increase blood flow systematically, but cutting off circulation, and then more effective blood flow in the needed organ. Again, mainly peripheral muscles that would enable the organism to run away. Or, I don't know, react. Or maybe fight. Okay. How does it occur? Opposite mechanisms are induced by the same molecule. So the beta receptors are coupled to stimulatory G proteins. Okay, so we're dealing with the same molecule, the epinephrine. When it meets a beta adrenergic receptor, it will activate a stimulatory G protein that in its turn will activate adenylate cyclase. This is an enzyme that produces cyclic AMP. This is the step where we will already enter the cytosol. or intracellular processes. Alpha adrenergic receptors, on the other hand, when they are when they recognize epinephrine, activate inhibitory G proteins, and they will inhibit the adenine cyclase and cause decreasing level of cyclic AMP. So this pathway causes increased level of cyclic AMP, and the other one decreased levels of cyclic AMP. Adenylate cyclase. Again, the enzyme that produces cyclic AMP, and that its function is activated or inhibited by the beta and the alpha adrenergic receptors. So adrenaline is another name for epinephrine. Okay, adenylate cyclase passes the membrane 12 times. It has a catalytic site that's composed of two similar catalytic domains right here. Cytosolic domains, and here you see the interaction, the basic interaction of the G alpha, the stimulatory one, I'm not sure it's the one, but the G alpha with the catalytic subunit, the cytosolic side of the adenylate cyclase. This is what is focused right here. And again, the catalytic side of adenylate cyclase is composed of these two catalytic subunits, the yellow and brown. The interaction between these components, the alpha, G alpha, and the catalytic side of adenylate cyclase, well, specifically the interaction is performed by the switch 2 and alpha 3, beta 5, the different regions in the alpha subunit. What you see here, this is the GTP, so it has to be bound to the G alpha for it to be active. And what you see here, phosphorylin, it's a substance, I'm not sure if it's a synthetic substance or not, but it's a substance that locks these two catalytic subunits together, and it's here not because it's endogenously here, but because it enables researchers to crystallize the structure together, or these two domains together, as was the case in the NMDA receptor, where they had a substance that stabilizes two structures together, which enables joint crystallization. Alright, so this is about the structure. Virtually all diverse effects that cyclic AMP causes in the cell are mediated through protein kinase A. Binding of cyclic AMP to both sites in the regulatory subunits of PKA. So we've shown the chemical reaction that takes place in the catalytic site of PKA only for a single catalytic subunit, but there is a small complex of PKA that's built of two regulatory subunits. The two catalytic subunits that are linked to the regulatory ones, the regions in which where the catalytic subunit holds the regulatory subunit is called a pseudo-substrate right here, because it mimics the structure of the substrate of the catalytic subunit, but the catalytic subunit cannot hydrolyze it or phosphorylate, change it. These are the nucleotide binding sites, and upon the nucleotide is a cyclic AMP, and upon binding of two cyclic AMP molecules to the regulatory subunit, the catalytic subunit dissociates and becomes active. Now, binding of the first cyclic AMP molecule lowers the KD, recall dissociation constant, for binding of the second cyclic AMP molecule. How did we call this phenomenon? Binding of the first molecule will change the affinity, or how good or bad the second molecule will bind to its binding site. And that is what mechanism is this? It's an allosteric mechanism, allosteric regulation on this protein. Specific kind, which kind is it? It's a it's cooperativity. Remember when the first, so proteins that have more than a single binding site to some ligand can sometimes be change their affinity to the second and third in cases where it's relevant binding. So this is cooperativity. Is it positive or negative cooperativity?
Positive.
Positive. How do you know? makes it easier, but how do you know it makes it easier? Sometimes it makes it harder. So positive cooperative is when the second binding is easier than the first one. That's good. So we said that it lowers the KD, the dissociation constant. So this is the way, this is the methodology that researchers use, and I urge you to try to ease into it. So dissociation constant, if you lower the dissociation constant, is the same as making the binding constant higher, right? Dissociation constant low, meaning it's the same thing as binding constant higher. Binding constant higher, high affinity than the second binding. So this is positive cooperative. Okay, and upon positively cooperative binding of these two cyclic NFP, the catalytic subunit dissociates and become active. Okay.
Are we saying what they do, or?
Yes, yeah, so the catalytic subunit phosphorylates or pKa phosphorylates target proteins. And we actually saw, for the pKa example, we saw exactly how it happens. In second class or something like that. So it adds phosphate groups to certain peptide sequences. And that leads to further downstream effects, which we will need further in the following slides. But all right. So another signal amplification occurs downstream from cell surface receptors, besides the fact that each alpha subunit activates several downstream effectors. So each epinephrine molecule, a single epinephrine molecule, will activate several adenylene cyclase enzymes. This is again because each G alpha will induce activate several adenylene cyclase. And if we follow the pathway which we just described, so a single adenylate cyclase would produce several cyclic NP molecules, so again amplification. A pair of cyclic NP molecules have to be and remain bound to the pKa for it to be active and phosphorylate downstream effectors, so there is no really amplification in this step, but a single pKa, single activated pKa can phosphorylate and then activate several downstream effectors, so usually enzymes. Then a single enzyme will produce several products, so again amplification. Generally speaking, the more steps in such a cascade, the greater the amplification and also the slower the process. So we discussed principally the factors that can terminate signal transduction, specifically in the case of beta-adrenergic receptor termination. Affinity of the receptor for hormone decreases, so receptor that binds the hormone, its affinity to the hormone, which is quite high, decreases after it activates the downstream G protein. And so what happens when it activates the downstream G protein? The GDP bound to the G is replaced with the GTP, which is in the sequence of events slide. So after the GTP is replaced into the G alpha in the G protein, the affinity of the receptor lowers to the hormone lowers. This is just due to, again, conformational changes. Also, cyclic NP phosphodiesterase, so this is the evil twin for the adenylate cyclase, which produces cyclic NP, phosphodiesterase cut cyclic NP and pushes it back towards its linear shape. So it becomes functional, thereby terminating any cellular response that's dependent on cyclic NP. In prolonged activation, there's also phosphorylation of several serine and threonine residues in cytosolic proteins. The cytosolic domain, of the receptor by pKa and the receptor, and that leads to receptor deactivation or desensitization. I'll show what I mean. So if this will be the plasma membrane and receptor, so it's receptor one. If there's a prolonged activation of this receptor by prolonged exposure to a hormone, so it will lead through the steps we've mentioned to phosphorylation or activation of pKa. Then this one becomes active, let's put a star.
TKA can then phosphorylate several membrane receptors, among them the receptor that specific receptor in which initiated the activation of the PKA. And so if it phosphorylates it, it becomes not functional, it becomes desensitized, the receptor itself. PKA is an example of heterologous desensitization because, as I said, it's not only phosphorylated, desensitized by phosphorylation, the receptor that specifically initiated its activation, but also other receptors that sit on the plasma membrane. And so, phosphate group. And so this is why we call it heterologous desensitization, because it happens in a broad manner. So it's a negative feedback loop in this cascade. In the beta adrenergic receptors, there is also an example. There's also an enzyme that's called beta adrenergic receptor kinase, specifically beta adrenergic receptor kinase, called this BARK, that desensitizes the receptor, or only the receptor that caused its activation, hence the beta adrenergic. And this is why, so we call it